On today's show, we talked to All White's assistant coach, Neil Emblen. Embers was born in South London, but for the last 15 years has been an integral part of the New Zealand football landscape. He came out as a 34-year-old, played a few seasons for the New Zealand Knights before moving to Waitakere as a player coach, where he enjoyed five very successful seasons. He was the director of football at Western Springs, and in that time, he was the interim All Whites coach, he was the assistant All Whites coach, and he assisted Baisley at the Under-20 World Cup. Most recently, he's been working in the MLS with Colorado Rapids. He spent two seasons there, and he's back now for a summer holiday, so we're very fortunate to have Embers stop in at the pod. Great guy, Embers, one of football's nice guys. You're not going to find anyone who's got too much bad to say about Embers. We spent just under 2 hours with him, and we covered a lot of territory. He opened up about Anthony Hudson, who got removed as the Colorado Rapids manager, and some of the testing times there and what that relationship was like. He spoke about his playing career at Wolves, 200 games for Wolves, and in between he moved to Crystal Palace as a £2 million signing. And we spoke about his relationships with some big names, Tim Howard, Ryan Nelson, you know, leading the Olympic campaign, and Waitakere and Roy Krishna, and you know, where he could have gone if perhaps a professional club had taken a look at him earlier. So there was a lot. We covered a great deal of territory here. I hope you enjoyed this one as much as I do. Yeah, enjoy it. Neil Emblen, welcome to Between Two Beers.
Gentlemen, good to be here. Nice to see you both.
We're in the NZ Me Studios tonight, which is a bit of an upgrade and a bit of a treat. And perhaps the improvement in quality is representative of the guests we've got tonight, because Neil Emblen is a big hitter in the New Zealand football scene. And I think when we started the podcast, Shay, he's someone that was very high on our list, if not the top of the list.
Yeah, I'd say definitely top three.
Because he's been around, isn't he? And he's got he's had a career. He's had a good managerial career, which he's kind of in the middle of, and he's got a lot of stories to tell.
Played a bit too.
So the way we do things here, Embers, we like to start by giving the audience a bit of frame of reference. So Shay, how do you know Embers?
New Zealand Knights. First, I was a fan, and then through working at OFC, when Neil moved to Waitakere, dealt with him as a player and then as a coach. Then I had the pleasure of being his manager for the Olympic campaign in 2012. And then I guess been friends. Had a Christmas party once. Few scoops on the North Shore, which was a good night.
Very nice. Almost like family then, aren't you?
Yeah, I'd like to think so.
Wow.
And then disappeared off to the States, and we kept in contact ever since. And now he's back here, and now he's on the cast, so good things. What about you, Steve?
Yeah, me and Embers have, I guess there's two facets to our relationship. There's the Embers who was a coach and I was in the media, so I think I might have got comments from him as a Waitakere coach, as an All Whites coach.
Waitakere, I think it is.
Waitakere. And as a New Zealand Under-20s assistant. And there was one season where we sort of blurred the lines, and it was actually a player-coach relationship.
Did you coach?
I played, wow. Believe it or not. I think 2012, Waitakere, very good side. Yeah, Embers was coaching, and I was sort of trying to force my way into the attacking lineup there.
Yeah, a few players ahead of you in the pecking order.
Yeah, look, there were, and we sort of touched on this in the Aaron Scott interview. What, you know, spoiled for riches in that team. I think you had Roy Krishna, Ryan DeVries, Alan Pierce, and me and Sean Lovemore and Gagami Finney all fighting for often two or three striking positions. But I kind of that was the last season I played National League, and I can't really. Do you remember what happened there?
Well, I think Neil realised he'd made an error in signing you. And
no, yeah, I do remember now. It's all coming back to me. So I think what happened was I started the job at the Herald and Embers. I made him aware that I was going to start working weekends, Saturday and Sundays. And
good start. You didn't give him the Bunsey ultimatum like you...
Yeah, I'm aware now that the more these podcasts we do, the more it's making me sound like a bit of a dick. Basically, the story went that we had an O-League game, and I think Embers had come to me and said, look, you're not getting a lot of game time in the league, but I think in O-League I can use you. We'll go to the islands, we might play a bit differently. Maybe there's a quota on how many Kiwi players you could have or something. I think the O-League might have been my big break. I got the passport, and I think the week before the game, I think in the Fiji game, Embers sort of said, look, Steve, I've got some bad news. there's only a certain number of people that we can actually put on the plane, and with the physio and...
I think that's my fault, actually,
because
we did restrict the number of tickets that we paid for, so maybe
partly to blame, but anyway, the crux of it was Embers said, look, Steve, I've made a decision that I'm actually going to put myself in ahead of you as the striker. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know what, Embers, it's fine, because... I'm at a different point in my life, and it was the right call, you know. Because and we'll touch on a little bit of this later. I understand we're quite far into this podcast, and you haven't really spoken yet, Embers. I'm going to give you a chance.
So good.
But you did have a bit of quality in your later years. I know you came out to New Zealand as a 36 year old, but you know you must have been 42 in that YTAC team, and you still have.
I think I was a bit younger, but yeah.
He's killed you.
Great.
Do you recall that at all?
Yeah, I mean, obviously that was it's difficult. I mean, I did try when I was when I joined YTAC, we had a really old team. You know, I think that we had a back five, and Danny was in it. Neil Sykes, Bayes was right wing back. Jonathan Perry. It was and Simon Heady in goal. It was like the oldest back five plus keeper ever. And I think when I became a coach, I wanted to bed in some young players, but still keep a few experienced boys around. And one of those experienced players was myself. And you know, when there is limited air tickets and things like that, I class myself as a bit of an emergency striker. And I've done it a few times, but. It was probably that was what it was, Steve. But hopefully I'd done it in a way. I did pride myself on man management, and you know, I was always quite honest with players and tried to do the right thing and give them the information, whether they liked it or not, really, but give it to them first before anybody else knew. Or and it was just one of those tough decisions that you have to make, and I did it quite a few times, probably to quite a few players.
This pod's all about repairing relationships. You know, me and Bunsey, you know, mended a bridge a few weeks ago. So, you know, it's just good to get this out in the open.
You mentioned that you did it a little bit. I think Steve and I were talking earlier today about you turning up for Western Springs against Melville in a match at Seddon Fields.
So this was the last time I saw you play. And I was playing for Melville, and, yeah, it was a Friday, Saturday night game. And you came off the bench for the last 10 minutes, I think. And you were electric. And this was 3 years ago? 4 years ago? Might have been 4 years
ago.
You
won the Div 1 title and got promoted to the Premier League.
But I remember you come on and you put yourself up front and you're bringing things down off the keeper and you're getting out wide and you're jinking past players and you went on this incredible mazy run and just sat this perfect cross up for the, I can't remember who the striker was, to come through, and he's just volleyed it over the bar and you've just gone down with your... head in your hands. Oh my God, that was it.
I think it was sort of coming to the end of my career. I mean, that was a lovely thing about coming to New Zealand. Like you say, I came here really late, and it's great to see the Phoenix and teams signing players a lot more in their prime than I was. You know, I think the key to it was, is, you know, I just felt it gave me an opportunity to play for longer, because I felt I could at the level that New Zealand football was, and I loved it. I mean, there's no better way to influence a game than actually playing. You know, I find that as a coach, one of the most difficult things. I'd rather get on there, and that's why I played for as long as I could. You know, you can definitely influence a lot more when you're playing. Mm. But yeah, like I say, I still love joining in. I join in training the odd day for the Rapids now. If we get an injury during training and we've not got the youth players training next to us, I'll be the first one to jump in. So I still love that as well. I still try and be the best player even when I join in with them guys. So just something within me, and it's always been my life. So, yeah, it's been tough for a few people to take that. I mean, I get that. I remember Anthony Hobbs won, he was a good young prospect coming through at Waitakere, and we had a grand final. And Chris Bale got suspended. I hadn't played for 3 months, and I played myself in the grand final against Auckland City.
Is that the one where you got sent off?
No, it wasn't. No, that wasn't. That wasn't. I got sent off twice in my career. Seamus, we'll bring that up later, probably. Well,
apparently, you're still fuming about it. And I can see it by your body language. Yeah, still no, we'll talk about that later.
But I actually left out a young player for a grand final, which must have been tough for him. He hadn't played much. I hadn't played at all, but I just plumbed for myself, and thankfully Michael Guiver came on late in that game and got us a goal got us an opportunity, and Pritch scored an own goal, and we ended up winning the game, and winning the championship. So it worked out, but I also have probably quite a few people that I've feel the same way as you.
I think it's impossible not to like you, Embers. There you go.
Well.
Well, that's nice, Seamus. That's why you call me a mate and I call you a mate, I suppose, isn't it?
That's why you spend Christmases together. That's lovely. So we're gonna jump around a little bit, Embers, and I do want to get your whole playing career, because I think you've got some really interesting stories to tell. But I actually want to start going back about 5 years to 2014. It was Ricky Herbert had just left the post as All Whites coach, and you came in as the interim manager. And you looked after two games, Japan away, lost 4-2, but played some pretty good football. And then it was South Africa at home at Mount Smart Stadium, and it was 0-0. So after those two games, it was kind of this is almost Ember's job to lose. And I remember the press conference after that South Africa game where the players, you know, you were the guy. I remember Glenn Moss going in the press conference, and he was fronting up saying, look, the players want Embers. He's the one that we want. New Zealand football obviously went in a different direction, and Anthony Hudson got the job, and then he came in and I think initially said that he would keep you on board as his assistant, but after what I think he described in the papers as one of the most difficult conversations he had in his 12 years of, you know, managing football, let you go.
It's probably as hard as my conversation with you.
So I was wondering if you could just take us back to that period of your coaching career and sort of run us through, you know, the emotions and where your head was and what it was like for you.
Yeah, I mean, I've been given a lot of great opportunities in this country, and sort of having a decent playing background allowed me to probably get jobs that I may not have got in the UK. So this was just one time. Obviously done the Olympics, obviously worked under Ricky for 3 years, I think maybe it was, before the Olympic campaign. And then, the All Whites job came up. Everybody's saying, apply. And I just said, look, well, my interview's these two games. And I thought in the two games we've played some pretty good football. I blooded quite a few young players, gave a few players their debuts, like Tyler Boyd and Ryan Thomas. They got their first games and they played excellent in the game. And we had sort of an exciting look to us. But I had no problems then bringing Anthony in. After working with him, an unbelievable coach, really experienced for a young guy, you know, 10 years younger than me, but his knowledge of the game opened my eyes. And I learned a lot of stuff from him. So them doing that, to, you know, it wasn't, I never take anything personally. I just get on with it. I think another opportunity is around the corner. And I just got on with things. You know, every game that the All Whites played under Anthony before the game, I always texted him and wished him all the best. And obviously he remembered that. And as soon as the opportunity to get me involved into the 20s, with Darren came up, he was like, yeah, get Neil involved. We want Neil in the organisation. So I knew it was just more the case of, you know, he wanted to surround himself with people that he knew and he trusted. And that happens all the time in football. And I just accept that. And, you know, because he got me involved, I knew it wasn't anything to do with my coaching ability or my personality or anything like that. So, you know, it was good that, you know, it all worked out really. And, you know, another opportunity came up to work with him. And, you know, I'm in America now because of him.
Obviously, it's hard for you to talk on behalf of Anthony, and I don't know how he would look back on his 4 years coaching the All Whites. But some of the comments coming out of the camp, I think I heard Ryan Thomas say last week that he really enjoyed this recent camp, and he made special mention of the fact that it was a Kiwi coach there, and he loved being back with the Kiwi boys and guys that knew what the All Whites were all about and that sort of culture. Do you think that Hudson now, when looking back, might have admitted or realised that he made a mistake by letting you go as the assistant and bringing in Alex Armstrong, because he lost a little bit of that sort of transition into, you know, keeping that Kiwi culture?
No, maybe. You know, I mean, like, I also feel, you know, Danny's perfect to be All Whites coach because he is a Kiwi. And that's the one thing, you know, this is my adopted country. I've been here, you know, nearly 15 years, and it's... you know, I feel Kiwi, but I'm not, you know, it's not, I wasn't born here. And when you see Danny talk about, you know, the culture and you know, the what's expected, you know, the history of this country in sports and some of the iconic Kiwis that are out there and the way he brings it all together, being a Kiwi, it's so much easier for him to articulate it all, speaking with the accent that he does. It's all there. It's something that I was really impressed with this last tour, the way that the new culture program had started, and what was being put into place, and I think that's a lot easier when that the main man is a Kiwi.
Mm. So, well, fast forward, so 2018, 4 years after you sort of Hudson took you out of that assistant position, then he brought you back in. You've obviously kept a good relationship. Then he gets the job after the All Whites at Colorado. And so you and Baisley go over as assistants. So talk us through, how difficult was it to take that job, and what were the factors there, and what was that like?
No, yeah, not difficult at all. I mean, I'd had 5 brilliant years at Western Springs. You know, I think I really enjoyed it. I think they'd think that I'd done a decent job there, and we were a Division II team. It was a sleeping giant. Everyone told me it was a sleeping giant. And we've gone there, we've gotten back into the Premier League. We did have a relegation, which is also good for me to experience, you know, as a coach. But it was pretty successful. And then Anthony, you know, I was involved with Bays with the 20s, so I knew what was going on with the all-white scene and the way that Anthony's direction was and the way he was going. And then he gets offered the job, and he appointed Darren straight away. But, you know, he had an opportunity to get a second assistant in, and he asked me, and I thought, well, this is, you know, me sort of sending those texts and staying involved and not chucking my toys out the pram, in a way, has given me this opportunity now to go and be a professional coach in a league that's developing. You know, I spoke with my wife and my kids, and, you know, it was the next step, and I've not looked back. I don't regret that decision. I can still keep a, you know, with your news reviews, Steve, I can still see what's going on with sport in this country. And, you know, it's so much easier to stay in contact here now with all the internet stuff and all these different websites and apps that
podcasts
that
and things.
Yeah, podcasts. Yeah, of course. So, yeah, it was a great opportunity. And I've loved the 2 years that I've been in Colorado and within MLS and working with professional players every day. It's just a dream job.
So you mentioned your family. So obviously, well, for those that don't know, your wife and kids have stayed back in New Zealand. How difficult's that been for you being away? I mean, you know, I know you mentioned you can keep in contact and stuff.
Yeah,
but you can beat
but,
and being around.
No, that's right. But, you know, I was working. You know, I was working mornings before school. I was working every evening of the week, and I was out most of the weekend. So, you know, they didn't. You know, but the thing is, you are coming home and you're sleeping in your bed in your house, and you are around your family. So it was tough, but I probably actually sit down and speak to my daughters now more through FaceTime and WhatsApp, and actually have good chats about what they're doing. and than I probably did when I was actually working in New Zealand. So we've sort of made that, you know, that we my wife knows it's a great job. She followed me here to obviously New Zealand, and she's loved living here, and you know, they feel Kiwi, and they, you know, we're on the North Shore, and everything's cool. And they walk the dogs on the beach every day. It's just, yeah, they were never going to come with me. The girls are 16 and 20, and they've got their lives here now. When we actually moved to New Zealand, the kids were 2 and 6, so it was a great time to actually leave England before they got sort of to entrench there. So it's just, yeah, that's worked out nicely, and my wife's let me follow my dream. She knows it's a great opportunity for me, and she's quite happy living on her own, I think.
Loves it. So at Colorado, talk to me about what your role actually is. You're the assistant, and Bayes is the assistant. Are you sort of got separate jobs to look after? Is it
not so much now under the new regime? We're pretty much got the same sort of job. We're, I do a lot of analysis for the players. So every Monday after a game, I'll have their clips ready for them. So part of the way modern day football's going, you become part analyst, part coach now. It's just the way the game's going. You know, we're lucky enough at that level to be provided with the software we need to be able to do that. And you know, I've really, you know, compared to what I was like 2 or 3 years ago on the analysis side, I've learned a heap in that department. And we've got Jace Kim, who's obviously joined as well. At the same time, he was Anthony's assistant analyst, and he's been great to learn off. He's back in New Zealand at the moment as well, and enjoying his time off. But yeah, he's been great for me as well to learn that side of the game off. And Bayes does a lot on opposition. We sort of split opposition stuff as well, but Bayes probably presents on that more than I do. Next opposition coming up, and with Anthony, Bayes was getting the last three opposition games all put together and cut up as well. So he's obviously doing a lot on the analysis side, so we can present to the players and to the head coach what we feel the next opposition is trends are and the way they are. And obviously he'll have his own ideas, and we'll just pick stuff out of that analysis. So it's been great. It's 24/7 football, and that's the like going back to the family side of it. You know, you've always got a game to review. You've always got the next game to look forward to. You've always got a game the following week. You've always got a cup game coming up. You know, it's there's always, you know, work to do. A lot of it's on your computer. You know, you do get your 2 hours on the grass with the lads every day. But, there's never a dull moment. There's never a moment where I'm sitting around bored in Colorado doing nothing. It's always pretty full on. And obviously, get a chance to see America in a different city every other weekend, which has been brilliant.
And doing it with one of your best mates, I guess.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, we get on great.
Have you thought about doing a podcast with him?
Yeah, he could. Yeah, good luck getting him in here. But he's a great lad, and you know, I've known him since '99 when he joined Wolves, and our wives are great friends as well, and they keep each other company here. Sandy, his wife, travels out a lot to America. She gets to see him a lot more than my crowd do. But yeah, it's been great to sort of have a mate there as well. But you know, it's when you go into a new team, you've got, you know, 25 new player mates. You know, not that they're mates, but you know, I'm lucky enough. You talk about roles, Stevie. My role is, you know, I've always been the closer one to the players as an assistant. And Darren under Anthony was more, you know, he was more Anthony's right hand guy.
Was he bad cop?
No, not bad cop, but he would. More bad cop than me, you know. It's always I always seem to play the good cop, and then when bad cop does come out from me, everybody knows it's bad. So, we're sort of different personalities, but he can also play good cop really well.
I don't think I ever saw bad cop Embers.
I don't think there is a bad cop.
No, there's a bad cop. There's a bad cop at times. But
he wouldn't have come out at White Hart that often because you're winning. Yeah. You're winning every week, so he probably didn't need to.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, like you say, the O-League, that's one regret that we didn't manage to knock off Auckland City in the O-League. I mean, we won the four championships in a row, but the O-League was the real money game, wasn't it? You know, and we didn't ever manage to get past them in that department. So that's a regret and a sort of, not a down, I don't know, what would you call it? Domestically, we done really well, but just the O-League and it was just a hurdle too far for the squad. And yeah, we disappointed in a few games in it, which was, yeah, it was tough to take at the time because I felt, why were we better in the league and why could we get up for those big games, but then in the O-League not be quite as good? But we were well resourced. I mean, I must say, you know, you sort of talk about success in the National League. The Auckland City and White Hart squads were so much better than everybody else's.
How good were those squads looking back at some of them? Eh?
They were. I mean, like, I think you mentioned about that your time. I think you'd probably been forgetting Ryan DeVries was around that time as well. Dakota Lucas was around that time, as well as the four senior ones that you've mentioned. It's
all much better than Steve.
I don't think anyone's
I just want to really reinforce it. Yeah,
Embers
as well.
I did want to try and sort of have a team that was good enough to win and compete for everything, but also give young players a chance, and your Zane Souls and Dakotas and Ryan DeVries, and all these boys that came through. Sean Lovemore was, you know, playing in the youth team, and then the odd game you're playing. You know, Ross Haviland, all these boys that
Luke
are doing.
Adams you had
still,
as well.
Luke, yeah. Kane. Yeah, we had some great players, yeah. Yeah. I mean, you're nailing them, Shay.
Good on you, Shay.
Yeah, so it was good. It was good to develop them as well.
I'm going to move things away from Waitakere. I want to spend a little bit of time digging around your MLS experience because you've been there 2 years, and I think probably fair to say it's been a bit of a whirlwind, a few tumultuous years, you might say. I think the first year was the club's worst season in MLS, and
I think the points tally was pretty close to being one of the lowest it might have been the lowest. I know it was. Yeah, we finished with a couple of wins, and it might have just got us above. But yeah, we were. It was a tough year. First year was a tough year as well.
So there's a lot of pressure there, obviously, on Anthony. Does that rain down onto the assistants? Are you feeling it as much as he is in that situation?
Well, because we're like 24/7. You know, most of the time our families weren't there. Like you're looking for solutions. You know, chances to refresh your squad. It's what Anthony sort of inherited there wasn't a great squad. They were down the bottom the year before he took over. He made a lot of changes, brought a lot of players in. And they needed to settle into the league and get to know the league. I mean, like 2 years in now, my knowledge of the league compared to 2 years ago is huge. You know, I'd know, you know, nearly every player in the league, you know, in extensively, and you know every player, every opposition that you're playing it coming up against, you'd know their key players, the way they play, the general system. You know, that would have been hard for Anthony to get in 3 months before he joined in November, straight after the World Cup qualifier against Peru. Then obviously must have interviewed and probably knew he was getting a job maybe start of December, and the MLS was kicking off in March. You know, and for as much as you back your coaching ability to work with what you've got and to sort of put your own stamp on things, it was still going to be very, very tough. You know, it's a good league, unforgiving league. Every team's got, you know, normally most teams play 4-3-3. They've got a brilliant number 10 and a front three that's worth millions and millions of dollars, you know. So It is a tough league, and they were. He was still trying to rejig the squad around to be strong enough to compete every week. And there were some tough times. But Anthony never shirked it and passed it on to us or made us feel under any real pressure. Reassured that this was a work in progress, and what we were doing as a coaching staff was the right things. You know, I'm sure we worked harder than any other staff in the league. He was at the height of that. You know, his work ethic was unbelievable. But maybe that was just too intense for a lot of those American players. You know, I can't put my finger on why it all changed when he left, but we all of a sudden started doing a lot more simple stuff. And
so let's just give a bit of context for the listeners who might not be aware. So this year, Anthony started the season, I think it was 9 games losing streak, or
for 9 games yet.
And then he got the boot, and then the new gaffer come in, and there was a big turnaround, right? I think he went 12 games unbeaten.
He wasn't quite that much, but yeah, we had a couple of he lost his first 2 games, the interim coach, and then we went on a decent run. I don't think it was 12 games, but it was a good run.
So how do you explain that turnaround? What do you think has happened there?
Well, we signed 2 players the week after Anthony left. One was a American international, and one is a player that I believe is good enough to play for Ghana's national team. He must be knocking on the door. A guy called Lalas Abubakar, a Ghanaian lad, a centre-back. And basically he was a big reason why we just started getting results. He was an absolute monster at the back. And he gave us that athleticism that was missing for those first few games of the season. He was a big part of it. And you know, that must have been tough for Anthony to take as well. He signed a couple of players straight after he's left. And whether that was they were all set up before, I don't know. But those players made a big difference. But also the interim coach, I shared an office with him, like Connor Casey's, it was his first real coaching job, and great. He was a Hall of Famer for the club. I think he's the club's record goal scorer, so he's a bit of a legend within the club and Colorado born, Denver born even as well. So he just came in, and I think he just wanted to simplify everything for the players, not bombard him with as much information as Anthony was giving him. But, you know, that's the way Anthony was. He just wanted to give as much information to the players as possible. But Connor just did the opposite. He just basically done, you know, one meeting a week and instead of one meeting a day. it was actually a little bit more than that. He had match day stuff as well, but he just simplified everything, and those couple of addition players just made a massive difference. The lads started winning games. They actually got confidence. Confidence grew. You imagine being 9 games, no win. Every game was tough, getting tougher and tougher. And, you know, I'm sure players do hide a little bit when the pressure's on. And all of a sudden, all our players were flourishing because they were winning again. And, confidence is huge in football, and it was really hard to probably for Anthony to take. But he was asking us, what's the difference? What's the difference? And it was really hard to just say, I don't know. The lads just gained a bit of confidence, that first win, that first result, and a couple of additions that have come in have really changed things. So, tough situation, tough for obviously me and Darren and Jace, who all followed Anthony to Colorado, and it was a tough time for us this year. Those few weeks in leading up to Anthony being let go as well, and wondering about our futures as well.
Yeah, so was that. So Anthony gets sacked. Are you fearing that you're getting sacked too? Do you automatically know your job's safe? How did that all work?
No, none of us knew. I mean, we went in to go to work that Wednesday morning, I believe it was, and we walked in ready for training, preparing for training, and he got called upstairs and told he'd been let go. So we then got asked to go upstairs, and we were told that we was going to carry on, and there was an interim coach in, you know, the Connor, the guy that I shared an office with anyway, was going to be taking over, and we would be he would be needing our help and wanting us to carry on. So, you know, you being professional, you just prepare for the next game. And obviously, the deepest sympathy for Anthony and the situation there, but sort of had to just still box on and get on with work, really, and prepare for the next game. And it was terrible timing as well. My dad had flown over from England with his partner, and they were staying with me, and it was real tough time. But we just had to look forward to the next game and try to turn things around and show that a lot of the work that Anthony had been trying to implement and put into place, you know, there's a lot of players that he brought to the club that are now excelling and doing really well, and you know, he's got to take credit for that as well.
Mm. Can I fanboy for a minute? Mm. Is Tim Howard still at the Rapids?
He's just retired, Seamus.
What's he like?
He's top
like,
man. He's a
goalkeeper.
Yeah, he's
second favorite.
Oh, okay.
Well, I mean, that was one of the. I think Tim and Ryan Nelson are the two players that meeting them for the first time, you just want to say the right thing. You know, like, I've not been too worried about many other players that I've met when I've been coaching. But, you know, my first conversation with Ryan, which you'd have been in and around, Seamus, when we went away to the Olympics, that first conversation was, you know, let's go for a coffee. First time I'd ever met him, because he hadn't come to the All Whites games that I'd been involved in. So picking him for the Olympics and then meeting him at the Olympics was a big conversation. And you know, meeting Tim for the first time was the same sort of conversation. It was like, you know, both straight away, top guys, you just sort of, you know, made you feel reassured. It's okay, we know about you as well. We know what you're like. They, you know, they're professional guys. They do their homework. And yeah, Tim's been, you know, 40 years old, what an athlete, an absolute beast of an athlete. I feel for our goalie coach, who I share an office with now, goalie coach Chris Sharp. He's going to miss Tim like crazy. They were like proper buddies, and, you know, I think it's going to be a tough year for Chris next year without Big T being around. So, but yeah, great guy. Tim's going to excel in whatever he does. He's an owner. Like looking at owning a team, he could be a possible GM. He's doing stuff for ESPN, Champions League stuff. He's a proper clever cookie, and he's a great ambassador for.
Do you notice his Tourette's much?
You don't at all. It's crazy
knowledge there, right? You've been doing your research.
Yeah, no, he's amazing how he's managed to curb it. He does a lot of great work for that charity as well, and you know, he sees a. He's got Howard's Heroes after every game, win, lose or draw. And he obviously had a lot of losses the last couple of years. He goes out and he meets people in the same boat as him and gives them reassurance. And, yeah, absolute diamond of a guy. Yeah, it was great meeting him, and I'll definitely keep in contact.
It's a good league. I think people
excuse me.
Underestimate how good. I mean, Zlatan, did you guys play them home? I don't really know how the thing works.
They're in our conference. We play them home and away, both LA teams. Yeah, they're in the Western Conference, same as us. He didn't actually score against us. We beat them both games this year. We've done the double over them. You know, I don't think Colorado's a big enough team for him to turn it on in. He wants to shove it up all the big teams, and I don't think he classed Colorado as one of those teams. So it's nice, you know. People like Tommy Smith can, you know, say that they've played against him and had that experience and, you know, kept him scoreless.
I'm just going to dig in with one more Anthony Hudson question, Embers, and then I promise we'll move on to some lighter themes. But I think he's a figure of great interest to the footballing public here, and you're someone who's very well placed to give us a bit of insight into the man. I think, you know, his 4 years here, if you asked people, what did you think of Hudson's reign? I think the overwhelming majority of the football community would perhaps give a negative response. But if you asked the players who were involved and who knew him well and were at the training sessions, I think it would probably be a positive one. So there's a bit of a bit of a disconnect there. And I'm wondering if when he started, you know, he front-footed, he came in, he was very combative and quite confronting. He got rid of you, he binned Temps and Jose from the under-17s, he dropped Mossy, you know, he was quite abrasive. And perhaps he was a young guy who perhaps didn't have this great, well, he didn't have a CV which would perhaps warrant coming in and shaking things up so much as he did. He also had a lot of power at New Zealand football, and he was the master, the puppet master that could do everything. So after 4 years, it's kind of, I was talking to Shay about this on the way up, it's kind of hard to judge exactly how good of a coach he is, because I know firsthand how prepared and how intense and how ambitious and how, you know, how his whole life is football, and he was so driven to get to the top. But some of his results and some of the way the team played, in particular that sort of Olympic qualifying tournament, perhaps didn't marry up with a lot of the words he was speaking. I think he was quite prickly with media. I don't know if he rubbed them the wrong way or they rubbed him the wrong way. There didn't seem to be a good relationship there. And then you look at the crux of it is it all came down to two games against Peru. And I think the first game was the 0-0 draw, the World Cup qualifier. You could probably give him a pass mark. I actually thought that was quite a good result, and we played quite well. And then you lost in Peru, which was always going to be a tough game. But he left. He took you and Bayes with him, and there's kind of like this, well, what was that? Was he good? How good was he? Was he a charlatan? Was he the real deal? And I don't think people really know what the real answer is. And then he went to the MLS, and he didn't succeed there, and now he's kind of in the wilderness, and we're all thinking, well, what did we actually have there with Anthony Hudson?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think you hit the nail on the head with the players. You know, the players sort of in a way love how detailed he is. I think that it opened a lot of players' eyes here as to the kind of detail that he'll give you, and you know, I'm sure he stimulates players learning, and you know, I think the players would have learnt a lot and seen the game slightly differently after working with him. So you know, I think the players, well, I know all the players thought his sessions were great. You know, I think his sessions were great. You know, he's detailed, and the way he just everything is so organised. It is intense, but he's just the most organised coach I've ever seen. You know, he's amazing in that aspect. Maybe he does want results straight away, and not results. I mean, you know, if he tells a player it, this is how he wants, he expects it straight away. I think that sometimes can be, you know, small improvements maybe, which is a little bit more like the current regime, the current coach. He knows how he wants to play at the Rapids, but I think he's happier to have smaller improvements and see those improvements. But I think that's just the way Anthony was. He was 24/7. He wanted total professionalism. I think that's why feathers were ruffled here. He saw the All Blacks organisation and everything that they had, and the way how professional they are in everything they do, and he wanted the same for football. And you know, I think he just got frustrated by it, which sometimes, you know, you can get prickly with people if they don't see the things the same way as you do, or you don't want to improve as quickly as somebody else does. And I think he was pretty open with the way the first Christmas he came out and the offices closed for the whole of January. And he's like, well, what are we doing here? Are we going to be playing some games? And, you know, I could sense that frustration. Maybe, you know, it was tough to say this is a bit New Zealand, and we did give him a bit of a warning from that. It is different, but I'm a great believer that if he was coaching in Serie A and he had players that could take on the instruction of what he was asking for and the detail, and I'm sure we reference to Italian teams all the time. We looked at a lot of the way the Italians played. We had a lot of best practice clips where they're all Italian teams because they're tactically, that is the best league. You know, it's not the most exciting league. But tactically, I think the Italian coaches in stopping you and also the way they sometimes play in the attacking third, you know, it's up there. And I think if he was coaching one of those teams, you know, I'm sure he'd learn the language quickly enough to do that. He's an intelligent guy. He's amazing with his languages.
Did you ever talk to him about how he looks back on his time with the All Whites?
No, not really. I mean, when we were working together, we were always looking forward, you know. It was always the next, like I said earlier, the next opposition, the next game, reviewing the last game. You were so entrenched in your job that, you know, he had moved on. He had moved on to doing that job. And, you know, since he's left Colorado, you know, I've listened to his podcast that he does. And
has he got a rival podcast?
Yeah, he has, yeah.
Well, we try not to mention other podcasts on this show.
This is slightly more high performance stuff, and it's good. It's I think he's trying to learn in as many ways what he did wrong, and how he needs to improve himself, or what areas that he may need to improve himself, and they're all his decision. You know, I enjoyed working for him. I thought he was a great coach and a good guy. He was never.
Does he have a laugh?
Yeah. Yeah,
because
yeah.
You don't see that.
Yeah, no, he does. Anyway. No, he does.
No, he was intense, wasn't he? He was an intense.
That was my impression.
It's a trusting thing, you know. If he's around, you know, around
the lads.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, around people he works with, and he knows work hard, and you know, we had some good times, and yeah, he's.
Did you take him on a Christmas?
No
drinks.
No. No,
not that close.
Christmas drinks.
Oh, good stuff. All right, let's get into your playing stuff, because I don't know if a lot of people in New Zealand appreciate what a legend you were in your UK days. So you come over here at 36, and your career was pretty. I mean, you did the year of the Knights, but you were pretty much done. No offense, as a player, when you come out here.
I was 34 when I came.
34, okay.
Yeah, so finished.
Shay was on that research.
Yeah.
So I wasn't.
I'm just gonna run through a little bit of your playing history, and there's a few things that I want to touch on. So 93-94, you're at Millwall. You're at Wolves from 94 to 97, 89 games. Then you're at Crystal Palace for a year, and then you went back to Wolves and had another 100 games. So let's talk about that, because you went. It was $2 million move from Wolves to Crystal Palace in 97. So who was Neil Emblen then? What player were you? What were your strengths? What was that money like? What was that life like?
No, it was great. I mean, I had a whirlwind couple of years, really. I was playing an amateur till 93. I was just playing non-league stuff. There were scouts in the stadium every week watching. I knew I was going to be a pro. It was just a matter of time. Got told I was too small at 16. And then I grew 6 inches in the next 2 years. When I got to that when I got to 20, I knew that I was going to be a pro. It was just which team was going to take me and gamble. And when you're playing non-league, they're smallest little director's box, and it always seemed to be quite busy with scouts, and everyone would tell me before the game, they're here today watching you. And yeah, Mick McCarthy took the punt, and my club, because they knew there were so many scouts, it was a team called Sittingbourne. We were playing in the Beza Homes League, which is like it'd probably be tier five now. They paid £170,000 for me from a non-league team. I think it was the second biggest non-league transfer at the time.
What does that mean for you? How much are you getting of that 170?
Well, I mean, to be honest, at that time,
that's a good question. It's a good question.
Yeah, I was so naive at the time that I didn't know my rights in a way.
Mm. You need some sort of an agent or an advisor?
I did, yes, Seamus.
Here we go.
Yeah, where were you then? Where were you then? I just basically said, well, you can go. I actually took a pay cut to go to Millwall. It was the strangest thing. I was working and I was playing for a non-league team. So I had a job and I was playing for a non-league team. And I earned more money than I was earning when I went to Millwall and playing in the championship, basically.
Yeah. Wow.
But then I was only there 8 months And then that Wolves signed me for $750 that summer. So played 13 games, got in, played 13 games for Millwall, done well. And literally just life had changed around. I was then joining a club. We got 27,000 people at Wolves, first game of the season. And I had an absolute shocker of a debut. We won 1-0 against Reading, but I was so bad. They say it was the worst ever debut at Wolves, and we joke about it. I have a lot of banter with the Wolves fans on Twitter, and they said, yeah, but you came good. And,
well, talk me through, why was it so bad?
Literally, first, I was trying to be clever. So first, I was playing centre-back, and this is what you was asking. I was playing centre-back, and I thought I was a bit of a baller from centre-back. I was getting quotes of the young Alan Hansen and things like that. It was quite high praise. You know, he was a player I looked up to growing up, and I literally, ball's gone back to goalie, like first minute, I've just gone to get it off the goalie. Goalie's rolled it to me. I've just gone to roll it over the outside of my foot, and I've actually fell over the ball. It was sticky at August day.
Oh, wow. Is it video?
First game of the season.
Is it video of this?
There's probably a video. I've never seen it, and I've never tried to find it. So, but I can remember one of my best mates and my girlfriend were watching. Well, girlfriend at the time, Julia, she was obviously my wife now, and she just went... they were embarrassed, let alone me. And everyone was smashing me, going, who's this player we've signed here?
do you shake it off?
No, I played awful. I was up, but we won 1-0. I was playing centre half, we won 1-0. Mike Stowell, who's one of the assistant coaches at Leicester now, I see him sitting on the bench behind Brendan Rodgers. He was the goalie for us, and he saved my bacon on five or six occasions that day. And we somehow managed to scab a 1-0. I got dropped the next game. Rightly so, but the following game we played West Brom, and because Graham Taylor was the coach, it was like he'd lost trust with me at centre half, so he stuck me in the middle of midfield, and I had the game of my life. It was like I had so much energy. West Brom were our biggest rivals. It's the game the fans all want to win, and I remember we beat
Black
them.
Country.
Black Country Derby. Yeah.
You're allowed to say
and
that.
There was, there was 27,000 people there again, and I got a standing ovation. I came off with 5 minutes to go, and the Graham Taylor, this is what he was like. He was saying, I've brought you off so you can hear these fans.
So how old are you at this time?
So I was 23.
And so 23, centre midfield, Neil Emblen. What are your strengths?
Believe it or not, Stevie, I was so box to box. I was like a runner, like literally. I went from the next Alan Hansen to the next David Platt then. You know, Graham Taylor referred me to as the next David Platt. And, you know, I never reached these heights, but it was like I was like the championship David Platt for a time. And that season, played 20-odd games and I scored 7 goals. So that's not 1 in 3, 21 games, I think it was.
From centre mid,
yeah.
Decent returns.
Yeah. So I've got that little video for you if you want that one.
Put that in the show notes.
I love my time at Wolves. Wolves the club where, you know, still got such a great rapport with the fans. When I went back to get my British passport for my visa to go to America, I went back and watched the Wolves game and they had me on the pitch at halftime. And I never got to say goodbye to the fans. I think in all it was like 235 games I played for them. And everyone thinks that's amazing now because they're fifth in the Premier League. So at the time we were a championship team. No one knows that. I don't tell anybody.
Secrets.
Yeah, exactly.
But, so on the basis of that central midfield year at Wolves, then you got signed for $2 million.
No, so I had 3 years... 3 years at Wolves the first time, so 94 to 97. And I played, unfortunately, Graham Taylor got sacked. Mark McGee was a coach, came in. Colin Lee, Mark McGee was a coach after, and then Colin Lee was an assistant. He took over after Mark McGee left. But, I played in midfield, sometimes sweeper. Mark McGee played 3 at the back. So
it's when sweeper was a thing.
I played in the middle of a back three, played everywhere. I mean, one thing I'm quite proud of as a professional footballer, I actually played in every, started it, well, I played in every position. In the pro environment, I played in every position on the pitch. So,
even in goal?
I actually went in goal once, yeah.
Did you?
Millwall away.
Talk us through it.
Yeah, so literally I needed it for my full set. So we
Someone just injured the goalkeeper.
No. So it's it's not a good story, but we'd used all our subs and our keeper got sent off with about 5 minutes to go. He came out on the edge of the box and brought someone down, got sent off, last man. So I was thinking, here's my chance. It was against my old team. And to be fair, by that time, I'd started sort of gaining a little bit of weight towards the end of my career. And the keeper was quite a small guy. He's a lad called Jimmy Walker. He's now at Ipswich as a goalie coach, but great guy. But he wore this smallest shirt. So I've tried to stick this shirt on. And I'm actually playing against Millwall, which was my first professional team. So they were giving me dogs abuse anyway. You know, pretty tough fans there. So I've stuck this shirt on. And let's say it was pretty tight.
I know the feeling. I've stuck a few goalie shirts on in my time that have been a little bit tight.
We'll put a few photos in the show notes.
I just literally didn't touch the ball in my hands. So I just literally just wellied it a few times out and, didn't really have a lot to do.
Was that a predetermined
no.
you were going to go and goal? Because,
no.
fun fact, as a team manager, I always ask that question of a coach. Mm. Goalkeeper gets sent off and you've made all your subs, who goes in goal?
Mm. Yeah.
You can ask Des Buckingham, Jose Figuera and Sam Wilkinson.
Maybe we will.
Good. Maybe you should. Put in the show notes.
No, I didn't. It was just a opportunity. I knew that I wasn't going to have to do too much. I don't think I even put gloves on, to be honest. I just ran down the other end and stood on the edge of my box. We were pushing for a goal. I think I might have even went up for a corner as well. Just to try.
Good.
Yeah. So, Baze tells me about it because he was playing in the game as well.
So 97, Crystal Palace come in for you.
Yeah.
That's on the back of you having an outstanding season.
Goal.
I had a decent season. Yeah, I mean, we got to the playoffs, and Palace actually beat us in the playoffs, and Palace went on to win the playoffs and go to the Premier League. So Palace were in the Premier League. Wolves had missed out. Steve Copper had seen me in a few games, obviously, because we were in the same league in the Championship, and him and the new chairman that was taking over, I became one of the targets that was on the list. And, yeah, that's stupid money.
Yeah, at that time, so £2 million in 97, that's got to put you as one of the biggest transfers at the time, wouldn't it?
Well, I got one in 94. I was on a nice list. I was on a nice list in 94 with, I think the top was maybe 15 million, something like that. No, it might have been 5 million at the time. And I was 1 million, the one that I said was 750. It got in the newspapers, and there was Klinsmann, and there were some great players on the list. You know, I've got the newspaper cut out somewhere. Which was nice. But the 2 million one, I think like Alan Shearer was 15 million around the time.
Because Dean Saunders at 2.7 in 92 was the record for a while.
Yeah.
To Liverpool.
It's knowledge,
yeah.
Eh?
Dean Saunders.
That's why we pay you the big bucks.
No, yeah, Alan Shearer, I think, was at 15. Chris Sutton, people like that, they were big transfers.
Blackburn
was spending a lot of money. But, yeah, look, my time at Palace wasn't great. It was one of them. We had a new chairman. He came in, and I think I was a chairman signing as much as I was the coach's signing. I think I may have been a chairman signing. And he was sort of playing fantasy football and getting players that he wanted. And I knew pretty much from day one it was going to be tough. And if I'm honest as well with myself, I'd say that I was a good Championship player. That was my level. You know, I think in the Premier League, it was just, you know, players were just that much better.
I can relate to that, Embers, because, you know, I was a good Northern Premier League player. But, you know, National League.
Yeah, you could play National League. You could play National
League. You had the chance.
Just not.
Well, you played for what? Hey, you played for Wantox. Okay, don't sell yourself short on that.
Yeah, like that. That was a. It was obviously. I was a London boy as well, so going back to Palace, it, You know, I didn't want to leave Wolves. I didn't ask for the move. I was basically told, look, we've got to accept this. This is too good a money. So you're going to go to Palace. And at the time I was like, well, gutted to leave Wolves, but I could live back in my hometown, be around my family. But literally 8 months later, I think they still owed Wolves 900 grand of the fee.
Jeez.
And Wolves said, give us him back and we'll call it quits. And that's what they did. So I went back to Wolves and played there for another 4 years and loved my time again at Wolves. So it's nice to say I played in the Premier League. You know, it's something no one can ever take away from you, the fact that you did. But it wasn't a great spell and we weren't a good team and we were near the bottom of the league. And it was a bit of a struggle, to be honest. But it sort of just told me that I was a good Championship player. That was my level. And, you know, maybe if I'd have gone to a team that was higher in the league, I might have fitted in a bit more. But, yeah, in a struggling team, I was never going to be the one that could produce moments that's going to win games at that level. You know, especially from a midfield position, I may have been better playing at the back for Palace, but I did that a couple of times as well. And yeah, it wasn't a great reading. It was like being at the New Zealand Knights again.
What was your best position?
I don't know. I mean, like some people say midfield, some people say centre back. My dad swears by me at centre back. You know, and he's watched and, you know, closer than anybody my whole career. But yeah, like when I had the energy and, you know, a lot of the time when I'm playing, it was 4-4-2 v 4-4-2, and you'd look your opponent in the eye, and if you make a run and he doesn't come with you and you end up getting on the end of it, you know, I was good at that. It wasn't the intricate play in midfield. It was just more the physicality and the running power. And that sort of gets, you know, it wasn't, I was more of a baller when I was playing at the back than I was when I was playing in midfield. Midfield, it was all just breaking up play and bombing on and trying to get in the box. Because when you arrive in the box and you're 6'2", you know, when the centre-halves have got centre-forwards to deal with, it's, you know, if you can get away from your man, you know, that's what I made a little niche out of, really, just arriving in the box and being a handful for opposing defenders and try and outnumber them in sort of aerial duels and stuff like that. You know, it wasn't pretty at times, but that was Championship football. And
Those were my strengths too, Embers. You would have known that if you'd given me a few starts.
Wow. Sorry, Steve. There was too many in front of you, mate.
Now, Embers, we like to canvass a few of your mates when you come on Between Two Beers. So I'm not going to name names, but someone has suggested we ask you about the time one of your teammates nicked a double-decker bus to get home with. I'm not sure what stage of your career this was, but could you fill us in?
Yeah, it wasn't a double decker, it was only a single decker. But it was a big night. We were actually out of season. It was in Wolverhampton, and a lad was living with us, a lad called Brian Law, and he was a centre half, tough Welsh lad, real good lad, brilliant lad, good player, left footed centre half. And we're having a night out, we've all gone out suited and booted. It's been a night out turned into a morning after. 8 o'clock in the morning, my brother's with me as well, and those of my mates who are up from my hometown. Huge night. And basically, we walked into McDonald's and there's a few Wolves fans around, and literally a sausage egg muffin just missed my nose by about an inch. And I've just grabbed my little brother and said, look, we need to leave. So me and my brother jumped into a cab, grabbed a couple of more of my mates, jumped into a cab, went home. Half an hour later, I'm at home, and my phone goes. And it's Lawsy phoning me. And he said, Embers, he said, this is my one phone call. I said, what you done? He said, I've nicked a bus. And I was like, you what? He said, I think that the story of it is the bus depot was by the taxi rank, and I think it was just ticking over, and he just got on it and drove it. and crashed it on the ring road and had massive regret, and it cost him a lot of money in
buses in cheap,
Nora Railings and council. Wow. Yeah. So yeah, it was a big story at the time, and you know, great lad. So, you know, so disappointed with himself, and you know, Graham Taylor done a, you know, really good job for him in giving him character references, and you know, he had to do a lot of community service. That night out would have cost him a lot of money, and you know, we joke about it, but there was nobody injured or hurt, yeah, which is, you know, the main thing. But yeah, real big lesson learned. Funny sort of story to tell, and you know, there's other parts to the story that I won't share, but you know, like his mates were on the, you know, his pals from Wales were on the bus, and they were singing for "He's a Jolly Good Driver."
Oh, can you imagine one of your mates still on the bus and you and all your pals in the back?
So because I think it came up again pretty recently, because I think there was something to do with West Brom players or something. They nicked a taxi or something like that, and someone brought it up again and said, "Well, we had someone at Wolves who nicked a bus."
So one up, yeah.
So it was a funny old time. Good night out, but very expensive.
Let's bring you back to New Zealand then, because age 34, you've come back out and you've played for the Knights. What's your recollection? We had Buncey on who spoke a lot about that night season and the good and the bad of it. He got another contract on the back of it. You were at a different stage of your career. What do you remember from that season?
Well, I actually done two seasons. So the first season, with John Ad said, the season before Buncey came in, that was, say, in 05. It was the sort of inaugural year. And basically, you know, I thought it was brilliant at the start. It was like I got bought over, you know. Trust me, it wasn't a money move. It was a lifestyle move. It was, you know, it was ridiculous what I got paid, to be honest. It was after I'd relocated, I think I was out of pocket still, but no, it was you know, it was a good time.
Ridiculously low, is what you're saying. Yes, yeah, yes, okay. Yeah.
You'd done that before.
Yeah, done that before a few times, you know. I'd left there.
Where did you come from?
Walsall. Right. Yeah. So I played with Danny at Walsall, and Danny sold the dream of, look, come out, your family's the right age. And he was exactly right. They're the right age, come out, play in the A-League. Every other weekend we fly over to Australia and we play. Got a great stadium at North Harbour Stadium. And this was a stage where I'd the 1 year in the Premier League. All the rest of the time was in the Championship, apart from this one season with Walsall where we'd gone down to League One. So I was playing in League One, 34, and it was like, right, it's Grimsby away, Scunthorpe away, Brisbane away, Sydney away, Melbourne away. Sounds a little bit better. Yeah. So it was like, let's give this a go and sort of...
Been to New Zealand ever before?
No. Danny actually even bid on a house without me being here. He went to an auction, yeah. Wow. And he got passed in because I obviously didn't bid enough. But yeah, that was quite a scary moment. But came over. Yeah, look, you know, John Adsid was sick at the time. You know, I've heard such great stories about John and his coaching and his man management. He just wasn't able to be the man he wanted to be and the coach that he wanted to be and that he was. And we struggled, you know, again, recruitment. You know, looking back as well, you know, I'm 34. I got picked to do our skills, the A-League advert, you know, when they launched the A-League.
How many dudes are going to roll like this? We'll bring that out as well. Yeah.
But I was actually picked.
What are you doing? Step over.
I'd done a little push back and flick. It was running up a road. It was like, it showed my feet, which was quite good.
Lazy lift.
Yeah, the old lazy lift. And it was one of them where you just, if I was being picked to be a skills guy, at 34, English defender.
What does that say?
Like, we might struggle here. Yeah. And we did. And you know, no disrespect to any of the players. They were a great bunch of boys. It was just, you know, the recruitment was not as good as the other squads. It seemed like the resources were, you know, it was tough. But you know, I'm thankful that those guys that were involved and in charge there, that, you know, they got the team up and running, and we went for 2 years, and it became the Wellington Phoenix. And you know, they've got to take some credit for actually trying to get the team off the ground and trying to get football in Auckland at pro level. You know, I've still got respect for those people. It was just really, really hard. It was under-resourced, and we weren't as good as the other squads, and you know, it was tough to take. It was tough every week getting beat. You know, I hadn't had it before in my career, apart from that little spell at Palace where we were getting beat every week. But yeah, it was tough. But you know, on the same side of it, I'm seeing Australia every other weekend, and not that you see too much. You see a stadium, a training pitch, a hotel, and a bit of city centre. But it was still nice to say, you know, it was nice to be involved. And, you know, I was thinking, well, I was 34 and 35 at that time. It was like, you know, this is great. This is great. I'm just going to try and play my best. You know, I think a few people said that I did well. A few people said that I was too old. You know, you're always going to get that. But
it brought you to WITAC, where you enjoyed, I mean, some great years there.
Presume you took a pay cut for that.
Might have gone up.
It was actually about the same. It was great. You know, Stevie, on that side of it, I was like, it just enabled me to play, and I went to two Club World Cups. You know, it was O League final, toughest conditions I've ever played.
Yeah,
Seamus.
Cosser away.
Seamus. No, it was.
Yeah, Solomon's.
Yeah.
Honiara.
Yeah, Honiara.
Cosser, Ridgey's team.
Was it Cosser?
Yeah, but you 3-0. 3-1.
Were they called Cosser?
Yeah, Cosser.
Were they?
Yeah. Yellow and green team.
Yeah, and then we beat them 5-0 at home.
Rexy destroyed me.
He did.
Yeah, anyway.
Because you were celebrating with.
I wasn't, though. I was celebrating a job.
Stay professional, Shay. We're supposed to.
Job well
that.
Done. We delivered a great match day. 25,000 people. Flawless. Were you there?
Seamless.
Solomon's away?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was the one where we drew all over your arrival card and
Lawson
back into Aussie.
Lawson Tama Stadium?
Yeah, and we got diverted on the way home to Christchurch.
No, the first year, Stevie went there then. He went there. That was when I was still playing. Millie was the coach.
Yeah, yeah. Steve was there. Working for us.
I was working.
Playing in the O-League, forget it. God, no, this guy, terrible.
You kidding me?
Yeah. No, we were working.
Bridge
there.
Too far.
Right.
Yeah, we were all working.
I didn't know he was doing that. That was the toughest condition.
He didn't know he was a footballer. You were dry reaching on the pitch.
I was gone. If you ask anybody what I was like at halftime, I was so dehydrated. I was literally like, dry reaching, and I think some powder type stuff came out, and I'm like, what is going on with my body? And managed to get through the second half, and we just kept it down 2 goals. But yeah, second leg 5-0.
But Millie was at it. I remember post match, Millie was adamant they were going to go back and win.
It was madness. So many people. I remember a whole bunch of Solomon Islanders sitting on the toilet shed.
Yeah, and the roof collapsed.
And it collapsed, and they all fell down. And you
think,
shit, they're going to have to call the game off or something. And they're just all laughing, howling with laughter, and it spreads through the ground.
Yeah.
Yeah, crazy.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And that was Benji had a homecoming, and the whole, on the drive-in, everyone was loving it.
This was the crazy thing, right? So Benji and Commons, bless them, right? They both went off with 75 minutes gone. And they're from the Solomon Islands because they were too hot. Like, I'm thinking, what's going on here?
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm dry reaching at half time. I'm like, the white flag's out.
Yeah.
And them two come off. And I'm like, they're from here. You know? But they got used to the New Zealand temperatures. And
Palmerston North will do that to you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's right. It was the toughest conditions I've ever played in. And obviously we saw it with the 17s last year with a good little Solomon side, you know, losing 5-0. I've sort of 11 players playing, you know, the lights are on, but nobody's home.
Yeah.
That I've felt like that. And it seems like there's nothing you can do about it.
Mm.
You know, Mai scored a worldie, didn't he? Do you remember?
Mai,
yeah,
he was a player.
He was a great little player. Yeah.
Manawatu, eh? Yeah.
Yeah.
Was it Mai or was it James Nucker?
No, Mai Mai scored. Did Mai Mai score as well? Naka scored. Yeah. Naka was a good player. Yeah, lefty, wasn't he?
Yeah.
So we talk about those years at WITAC, and you had some great teams and you had some great players, and you're probably as well placed as anyone because you come through the professional ranks in the UK. How many of those guys, if they weren't in New Zealand, would have been professional footballers on those good WITAC teams? Because you've got guys there who are amateurs, but it seemed like they were far too talented for the New Zealand National League in a lot of cases.
Yeah, I mean that's probably another thing. At the time, I look back and I go, well, I think a few of those players should have been playing for the Knights. You know, a few of Auckland City's players should have been playing for the Knights. You know, Kieran Jordan was around then, Youngie and people like that. Like, you know, they were in their prime around that time, 2005. And you know, his players in the Islands probably would have helped us as well. But, you know, again, we go back to recruitment. But sort of looking back, I'm sure some of them players would have made us a better team.
We talked to Aaron about Roy. And when I was with you that year, it seemed clear to me, head and shoulders above the rest, that he was A-League at minimum quality. And he's gone on to prove that. Did you know, I mean, you had him at probably his very best. He was probably quicker during those 5 years at WITAC than when he went to the Phoenix. It might have been a little bit more raw, and maybe it took him a year to transition to the A-League. But it was clear he was top talent.
Yeah, he won us games. I mean, when things are tight and... You know, you need someone to pull something out. Roy always done it for WITAC. He was, you know, it was one of those times where we were telling everybody, he's good enough, he's good enough, he's good enough. And in a way, we didn't want to lose him, but it wasn't like we were hiding it. You know, we were telling people that we feel he's good enough. You know, Rex paid for him to go trial at North Queensland Fury. I think he went to Gold Coast United and had a trial, you know, and Rex was promoting him to the A-League teams. And yeah, it took too long, but Waitakere had the benefit. And I think that's why Roy now is probably going to play till he's 35, because I think the wear and tear on his body, because we only train 2-3 nights a week, rather than him being a pro at 20 and being burnt out by the time he's, you know, 30. I think Roy, his career will be extended just because of that time he had as a part-timer. And I think, you know, he's such a confident player. He's got the tools, left foot, right foot, both as strong as each other. I wouldn't know which foot he is. He hits it with such venom with both feet. But he's just his sharpness and his pace. And I think now, as he's got older and he's got on a weights program at the Phoenix, I just think you can see he actually now uses other people's bodies to bounce off. And actually, if he does start losing a yard of pace, I think his strength will take over now, you know, and he'll use other people's bodies to just bump and keep going with. And
I think that's what got him past a lot of defenders. They underestimated how strong he was because he was just a sort of little looking fella, but he was so strong on the ball, he'd just bump you off, wouldn't he?
Yeah, I believe he could play MLS.
Yeah, I was going to ask about
that. You tried to sign him, didn't you?
Obviously, because of the analysis type stuff, I can make a video and go on Y Scout, get goals. And like, you know, I pushed him a couple of times, and I think it was just difficult because he's a foreign player. And, you know, those spots in this day and age, every foreign spot that Colorado use or any MLS team is worth $250,000 per year. So if we don't use a foreign spot, you can sell it to somebody else within the league.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So you sort of had to add that to salaries and what a cost of a fee would be. And I think it was just like it didn't work. But, yeah, I believe he could play in the league.
And would he do well? Would he be a top, you know, what is and it's probably unfair now because he is on the wrong side of 30. But had he gone there, you know, mid-20s or, you know, how could he have been a top striker in the MLS?
Well, I think probably... You'd say he's been a top striker probably for 3 years now in the A-League. And I think the A-League, you know, it's not MLS. It's a good league. You know, I was at the game a couple of days ago, and the tempo's not quite as high as MLS. It's not as fast, it's not as athletic, but it's a very good league. Roy would find that tougher in MLS. The defenders are more athletic, and but he still would get goals. He 100% would get goals. He's a goal scorer, and yeah, he's got pace. Pace is his key, and you know he's got that in abundance. And I believe he's scoring goals already in India, and that might not be a great level, but he's cleaning up there and doing well. So I'm sure Roy's got one more move in him.
Oh, maybe still on your radar.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, I mean, I look out for Roy. He's a friend. He's a player that's given me a lot of joy when I was coaching.
Come out for drinks at Christmas?
No, I don't think I have.
Can't imagine he's a big drinker.
Nah,
Carver.
Gotta.
Let's talk Western Springs, because I think when you went there, it almost created a bit of a shift in club football, which a lot of clubs have kind of followed suit. And that director of football, almost top to bottom kind of control. How was that for you? Because it was a stopgap, wasn't it? Or it filled a void and allowed you to be full time in football, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it was a weird situation. I'd just come back from the Olympics, and I was basically given a bit of an ultimatum from Waitakere. Because I was assistant coach for the All Whites, and it was like you need to choose either Whitehack or the All Whites. So, you know, we'd won four leagues in a row, and I hadn't won the O League, and it was like, okay, right, I'll make a decision here. I think the All Whites is something I want to keep doing, and. So I sort of just basically said to Whitehack, no, I'm gonna carry on doing the All Whites, and I'll chance my arm and go away with the Olympic team and see what comes up. And a guy called Zoran Jerkovic basically just hounded me. Great guy. He's on the Springs senior committee, and he's now been made a life member. He's really good guy, but he was so persistent and kept phoning me and saying, want you to come to Springs, selling me the vision of the club, telling me about the facilities that were coming, because obviously at the time they didn't have the turf, but it was on its way and development had started. And basically sold it that you've got this sort of blank canvas, you can make your academy, we can have, you know, all different streams of football, sort of from elite to the grassroots stuff, and I could basically implement my own programs, run the first team, you know, obviously try and get the first team into a more respectable league, and that went well. And he just kept at me, and I was like, I just sort of went in on a sort of a part time basis, but it was like in the first year, it was like, let's see how this goes. And then obviously from year two onwards, it went to a proper full-time job. And yeah, I loved every minute. It was a huge club, great people. You know, they've got so many people in charge in running it. And this was the difference between Whitehack and Western Springs. I could affect so many more people at Western Springs. We had 140 junior teams. And 40-odd senior teams. I mean, I'd only really look over two or three senior teams. But those 140 kids teams, if I could affect, you know, a lot of those kids thinking and the way they play and just being there to watch and encourage. You know, when I was at Whitehack, we only had the first team and the youth team. So obviously less people to affect and work with. So, it really opened my eyes as to, you know, job satisfaction of actually helping a lot of people. And, I love my Whitehack job. I had five great years with Rex Dawkins, top guy, you know, call him a friend now, and meeting with our dogs. He actually went and got the same dog as what I got. He got one out of the next litter because he fell in love with my little doggy Ella when I took her to the ground. And
Rex named his dog Benji, by the way.
Yeah. Did he? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Not after.
Roy was gutted. But it was so and then going to Western Springs, it was a totally different job, and I loved every minute. You know, obviously the success of the first team, we had three championships in the 5 years and one survival year and then one relegation, so mixed emotions there. But just in the, you know, still going down there now and seeing little little young players that you've given that first opportunity to. And this is the thing, and I've sort of spoke to Steve about the managing side of it, managing people. You know, I chose every elite team from 8 years to 17 years. It was all on me, basically, my opinion, who I thought, which player. So when it gets to February every year and they're having trials and everyone's trying to turn up and be the best they can be because they want to be in that A team, you know, and there's some good stories about players that have dropped from the A team to the B team and to the C team and then back into the A team within a couple of years because of obviously everyone develops at different times. So there's so many great stories of just like, you know, little personal things that you just go that, you know, this kid's done well, this kid's, you know, gone above this kid and people are proud that their kids break through it. And I had so many good relationships with the mums and dads. They knew it was a tough job. They knew I had to make calls, but they all respected them. And yeah, I had some really good times. So yeah, there'll always be a club that I look out for to do well, and especially because it, you know, hopefully every year now they've got a production line of young players that will just feed into the first team. And you know, like we saw, they went pretty close last year to winning the Northern League, and I think they'll be able to do that with the local boys and girls that they've got within their ranks. They'll do well over the next few years as well.
It's probably a good time to give a little shout out to another Western Springs stalwart, Murray Wassey, who actually picked the right guest for the podcast this week.
Competition winner. We announced we were having a big hitter on the show, yep. And we got the Facebook fans to guess who it was, and Murray Wassey suggested Neil Emblen.
It wasn't after Friday, was it? Because like, it was his birthday on Friday.
Happy birthday, Mauser.
It was his birthday on Friday, and we went out for a little bit of brunch, and I'm not sure I said anything. I don't think I said anything.
Friday? No, it was before Friday. Just
it was
gone.
Before Friday.
So he's just picked it. He's good, like, he's good like that.
Yeah,
Murray reads things well, doesn't he?
Yeah, life of talent.
yeah, Murray's a great lad. Like, he's done so many hours coaching for me over those years, and the kids love him down there. He's you know, obviously he's brought Papua New Guinean teams down there, and you know they all. He's an amazing guy, and he's definitely one of the island boys, Seamus, that's come over and excelled, and has got a great following at that club. And they all love him, and he's doing great things.
One of the few to really rock a cheese cutter as well.
he
loves a cheese cutter hat.
Yeah, even on the sideline. Yep. I'm not sure I'm all for that, but.
No,
yeah, I've seen
Ross McKenzie pull off a cheese cutter this time.
I remember a cheese cutter in the Outback back bar in about 2002, Ross McKenzie, but there you go.
But no, good times. It's a good club. I'll always be fond of, so I hope they all keep going well.
Embers, let's talk 2002. 2002? Let's not talk 2002. I've had three beers. Let's talk 2012.
There you go.
Olympics. That for me is still one of my fondest trips, and I've been on a few. You talk about meeting Ryan for the first time, and that was my first time to meet him as well. Where does that sit for you? I know your dad came to the games, and I think that was quite special, but the whole trip, the whole campaign, I think, was pretty cool.
No, it was amazing. I mean, let's be honest as well, we actually scraped through the qualifiers.
Yeah.
We beat Fiji 1-0.
They hit the crossbar twice.
They did. It was a tough qualifying. I don't know. I think it's got a little bit easier now. That I think a lot of our players are better technically, and I think the gap between the island teams and our younger teams now is probably getting a little bit bigger. But we struggled to qualify. Marco got injured just before the qualifiers. He was playing for Melbourne Victory, and he would have been the star sort of player.
We were watching it
and Manny Muscat, they were playing the Phoenix.
That's right.
Manny Muscat puts one on him straight away. And we're like looking and going, please no. And he ended up coming off, and I think he'd done his collarbone or something like that. So, and obviously Woodsy was playing in England, so he wasn't available for qualifiers. And so we had a lot of... mostly local boys playing, and we scraped through. But that's the hardest thing. The unfortunate thing is for a lot of those boys who qualified, they don't go to the... You know, I remember having some hard, hard conversations.
Can I pick what the hardest one was?
You can pick, yeah.
Greg Draper?
Yeah, Drapes was quite hard. I mean, Drapes is still scoring goals.
He's still going.
He's still scoring goals at TNS, and you know he's got to still be, you know, he's doing well playing Champions League every year. Jason Hicks, I remember being a really hard one. I used to love Jason as a player, little lefty, and you know I thought he was a little bit before his time. He's a great little technician, and you know he would see stuff that other people couldn't see, and he was my type of sort of little midfielder, but he just wasn't. He just wasn't sort of strong enough at the time, and felt he'd get eaten up. But yeah, that was a tough one because, again, the Olympic stuff. There's no pay. All the players that were trying to get into the squad, we were training near enough every morning at Bill McKinley, so players were committing five times a week, and then you have to you know, for 3-4 months solid. And it's not like you've got a game on a Saturday, Steve, you know, it's like, this is the Olympics, and it's like, you've committed so much towards it. And, yeah, they were the toughest decisions, but as an experience, the whole Olympic campaign, the build up that we got some great games. We played
Saudi tour.
Yeah. Saudi tour Saudi as well. Tour, yeah. Melbourne. Yeah. And, I actually, on one of those, didn't go to one of the games. I think I had some club stuff with Wytek on. I think Raul took it, didn't he? One of them. It was the build-up we had actually before the Olympic Games was great. We played South Korea, we played Japan. Oh, yeah. We actually jagged a draw in Japan. Yeah, it was. Yeah, and they were actually, they were devastated.
Yeah,
they were
absolutely one of your favourite footballing memories, Steve, was when I gave the bib and drink bottle to Ryan Nelson when he came off.
So Ryan Nelson was your overage player.
Yeah.
Had you met him before you met up at the Olympics?
No. So I met him, Ryan
Japan.
In Japan.
How's that go down?
It was great because he just settled me down. I think I was giving it a big spiel to him and saying, look, I totally respect what you're doing for this country and the football, and you've been an amazing ambassador, and, you know, I'm just sort of newish to the country and just wanting to make my own way and not saying I'm better than anybody else, just being humble about what I do. And he just stopped me and he just said, Embers, he said, like, I've done my homework. He said, like, everyone speaks highly of you and you as a person and as a coach. He said, I'm here to do whatever you want me to do. And I was just like, shit, this guy's 36 years old playing in the Premier League.
Was he with Tottenham at the time?
He was either at Tottenham or QPR.
No, he went to Tottenham post Olympics.
Yeah.
Got him a move. Got him a move, did we?
You nearly got Moussa.
Well,
he did get Moussa a deal at Fulham.
Moussa got a deal at Fulham, yeah.
What was that like in the camp, having a guy who's on the verge of a contract with Tottenham around a whole bunch of sort of amateur
players? He was just great. He was just like a coach on the field. You know, like I've said about influencing the game. You know, as a player, you can influence it a lot more as you can as a coach. Ryan was that player for us in the Olympics. He just was in the right place in the right time on so many occasions, Seamus, when he was ridiculous, especially in the build-up games as well, to give us a little bit of confidence that we could go and get results. Yeah, he was, but as a man and as a mentor for all our younger players, because we had, if you looked at it now, if we had the next Olympic Games, there'll be hardly any players that aren't pros. Yeah. You know, whereas out of 18, we had 9 that were amateur players.
Do you recall training ground Dakota Lucas v Ryan Nelson?
Yes.
Can you talk us through that?
Well, it's just he showed a bit of lack of respect and, he was a silly boy. It was probably one of the times I did actually lose it. Yeah, bad cop came out slightly with him. Dakota was a brilliant young prospect and I had a lot of faith in him because he played for us at Wytek and he actually, one of the finals, grand finals, he got man of the match, scored a couple of goals against Auckland City again. He was amazing.
He was a talent, eh?
Yeah. But he didn't know when to be quiet sometimes. And that was one of the times where he disrespected Ryan. And Ryan sort of just said, I'm going to have nothing to do with him. But
what's your recollection of that, Shay?
Yeah, I think whatever happened in the session, it broke down. And then Dakota sort of intimated, look, we're not all professionals, Ryan. Said something to that effect. And then in the next sort of phase of play, I think Ryan gave a ball away and the Dakota might have sarcastically clapped. Or, nice one. And it was just sort of like everyone, it was like a look away moment at the time. And it's still, I think you might have sorted it on the pitch, but then it simmered back at the world's worst hotel, I might add, in Coventry.
Yeah, it was bad. It was just a smart ass moment, yeah. Wasn't it? He was a lad. Yeah. I don't know what he's up to these days, but at that time he was one of the best little prospects. And
well, I remember back at the hotel, like Tim Payne and Cam Harris, and the two youngest in the squad were just like, "DK, you can't. Yeah. Don't be a dick. Like, yeah. He's Ryan Nelson. Like, what do you think you're doing?" And it just kind of simmered down after that. But I just remember thinking at the time. Well, actually, no. Now that I've reflected on it, I think from your perspective, having to manage that, like Stevie's just said, you've got one of New Zealand's greatest players ever, and a group of amateur kids, and having to keep that group together.
We did have Smeltsy and Mike and McGlinchey as our other overage players, and to be fair, I tried to manage it right and get their opinions on things and have a bit of a senior players group and go with my ideas to them and get that reassurance and this is what we want to do and how we want to play. And yeah, the management side of it was great, and it's a great experience for me.
Good team manager as well.
Good team manager, sorting it out, seamless. Yep.
Do you have any of the peak kit still?
Oh, no. I might have some in my garage, but...
The shorts, have you got the shorts?
What about the little baby blue vest?
Yeah, yeah. I think I've got a photo of all of us
yeah,
in it.
Yeah, that'll be you. It was great. It was great. But just being in the Olympic Village was amazing in London. With it being in London, and in England, sat in Alex Ferguson's seat, coaching against Mo Salah.
That was a good game. Standing over for Marco, I think, at the end of that game.
The good thing was Brazil were playing after us, so the crowd started coming second half, and it was Old Trafford. And by the end of the game, the Old Trafford was full, basically, wasn't it? And... because they were playing Belarus after us, and the last 10 minutes of that Egypt game was just end to end. Michael O'Keefe made some great saves.
Shout out to News Hub's Michael O'Keefe.
Yeah, yeah.
No, we don't talk about News Hub on this podcast.
Michael O'Keefe.
He did cost us the goal against Belarus, though, which he'll always sort of hold his hand up as a disappointment. Yes, yeah, yeah. But, I had faith in him at the time and kept him in when Jake was fit. And, you go with those decisions. The whole Olympic experience, and then going to St. James's Park, playing Brazil, and they've got, Neymar, Oscar Hulk.
They Hulk against us.
They've got Thiago Silva playing at the back and Raphael, Man United right back.
At this point, is Neymar... Is he the world dame now?
Yeah.
I didn't know who he was, but all the boys were like playing table tennis with him. Yeah, Mark Oates still talks about playing table tennis with Neymar.
Yeah, he was up there. He was not...
Still playing in Brazil and sort of on his way.
No, I think he...
signed somewhere.
Thiago Silva had gone to PSG. I know that. Mm. And Lucas Moura, who's now playing for Spurs... He had gone to PSG as well, I think. I think I've still got the team sheet. It was just ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. And at 20 minutes in, I've still got a clip of us bopping the ball around in the middle of midfield. And I remember looking over at their coach, and he was thinking, he went mad. And then literally we were 1-0 down 10 seconds later where they nicked the ball on the edge of our box and just... broke and scored and then to be fair they took over the game, but it was just nice to have that moment where 20 minutes into a game New Zealand were playing slightly like Brazil and their coach was frustrated and then all of a sudden the game changed. But it was just nice to have that moment, and it was a respectable scoreline at 3-0 because it's we're there to win, not compete. But with the team we had and their team on paper, it was a good performance.
So let's round you off, Embers, because you're back now with the All Whites and you've signed. What's your contract you've got with the MLS? Are you there for another season?
Yeah, I've got one more season. I've signed a 3-year contract and one more season, yeah.
So you look to you see how things go and negotiate.
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to carry on. I mean, working with professionals every day. You know, obviously the staff there, the new head coach, he would have signed more than that 1 year. So it's just a case of building that relationship and working well with him and working hard. And
then, seems like family aside, I mean, the family is the sacrifice, right? Being away from the family, but you're working with an MLS club, you're assistant All Whites coach, so you're back in that environment. It seems like best of both worlds, really, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, to be back in camp with a lot of players I've worked previously with, you know, it's nice. There's a lot of young players now that I've seen grow up as well and now in the All Whites fold and, you know, performing well and getting opportunities. So yeah, it's you know, I enjoyed working with Danny. It was good. I feel like I can challenge Danny with my opinions and obviously once he makes decisions, then I'll back those decisions. But you know, I'm there to question. And I think with Danny, I'm the right person to do that. You know, there's mutual respect there and. And I love it that he's a Kiwi and he's passionate about the game here. And, you know, I immensely enjoyed the tour. The first game was, I thought, very encouraging and there were some great signs. But the second game was poor and we've got to be better, you know. So it told us a few things, but obviously everyone's going to continue to get monitored and hopefully we'll get some games in March to back up. And
did you catch up with Mick McCarthy?
Yeah, did you? I mean, it was crazy. It was, yeah.
Had you seen him since?
Yeah, I'd seen him a couple of times, obviously playing against them and stuff. But my sister actually bumped into him in a restaurant, and she couldn't help herself. She had to go and introduce herself to him, and she told him that I was going to be coaching with New Zealand, and we'd catch up. So, but ironically, Robbie Keane was on the staff, and I played with Robbie for Wolves. Yeah. And Terry Connor was the assistant coach for Mick. And Terry Connor was an assistant at Wolves as well under another coach. So the whole of the Irish staff I'd played with or worked with. Yeah, Mick changed my life. He was the first pro coach that I had. He was the one who told me all to pay the money and get me. So I'll always be grateful to Mick. But, yeah, it was good going head-to-head with them. And, you know, obviously they've got the playoff game, but I hope they go through. They're good guys.
And so what are the coaching ambitions? Do you want to be an assistant coach? Is the goal to one day be an MLS first team coach or a professional first team coach?
Yeah, look, I don't know what I feel about that. I love my job now. I feel like I help. You know, and that's the greatest feeling that you're part of a team that is trying to get results. Whether I've got no ego, whether you're the main guy, and that's the same with Danny. You know, as long as you're making a difference and you're part of a team that is trying to get results and trying to do things the right way and trying to, you know, help the game in your club or your country, then that's what I'm happy with. You know, I've been head coach and I enjoy the head coach role. But you know, I think MLS, I think I'm fine where I am at the moment. You know, it's a good role. I feel like I'm a good supporting person. You know, and yeah, maybe further down the line, I still feel fairly young for a coach as well.
You're looking good, Embers. You're looking like you might still be able to put yourself on for the last 10 minutes, yeah? I like Western Springs.
I'm probably actually fitter now than I was when I was playing the last 10 years. You know, I obviously get a lot of time to myself now. You know, the working hours aren't as much as what I had when I was back in New Zealand. So I live in an apartment and we've got a gym there and a pool and, you know.
So never say never.
I might have a comeback, on. I nearly joined in with the older boys at Springs this weekend, but I saw Baze down the beach walking the dogs and he said, if you play today, you'll get injured. So I decided not to play, tempt fate, I know. But further down the line, I really don't know. I want to stay as a professional coach as much as I can. Within MLS, I'm obviously very happy in the position I'm in. And obviously I want to support Danny and, you know, I hope that he's All Whites coach for the next two cycles at least. And we all go to the World Cup. You know, it'd be great to go to a World Cup. You know, that's something that I came into the All Whites fold after the South Africa, you know, stuff. And the stories I still hear from that and the experiences, you know, they live with everybody forever. You know, Rory was talking about some of the stories and some of the experiences that they had in South Africa. And, you know, to be an assistant and be part of that would do for me. It's not like I have to be the main man. And you know, I think I'm a pretty good supporter of people. So I'm quite happy with the positions I'm in at the moment.
Shay, you're our list guy.
Yeah.
We ticked everything off there.
Ticked most things. Just a couple, I guess, anecdotes or tidbits, I guess, particularly from your New Zealand career. Any particular reason why Canterbury United supporters gave you a hard time historically?